Hello everybody, I'm Valerie Capolo. I'm the director of the STEM Mentor Program here at Mass Bay Community College. The program is primarily a one-to-one matching of students, community college students, who we match with professionals in the STEM fields. We ask the mentors to commit for two semesters, so basically the academic year, and we ask for them to meet with their mentee once a month in person at least, and then to communicate more frequently during the month. Maybe they help their mentee apply for jobs or apply for internships or help them apply for summer research experiences, or perhaps they invite their mentee to come back to their workplace and job shadow them. Maybe they help them with a school assignment that their mentee is working on, or sometimes they just sit in a coffee shop and talk about life challenges, how it worked for them, and give them advice on their own career path. If you'd like to learn more about this program, feel free to contact me. We're particularly looking for women, people of color, and we need mentors in the engineering and computer science fields. Thank you.
I wanted to introduce Alfred Dermidja, the founder and president and CEO of TechFusion, and you are one of the first data recovery experience in both data recovery and computer forensics in the New England area.
My name is Alfred Demersian. I work at TechFusion. I started my background is electrical engineering, 1984. I studied up to halfway through PhD, then I started working for two companies. In 1988, officially, I started TechFusion. I started working for Harvard University and NASA as a consultant, and they had a certain project that they had to measure the pollution of the ozone layer, and they had a certain test that the equipment would have to, through a balloon, had to go all the way above at the ozone surface, and every time it landed, it would crash the hard drive. For them to perform the same test, not only they had to spend $1 million, they also had to wait for the right weather condition. The weather condition did not mean rain or snow. It meant for all the ozone holes to gather together. Back those days, we had the communist countries, so it was difficult for them to set up there. So they asked me to look into data recovery. That's how I started data recovery. Should I repeat anything?
No, that's fine.
So that's how I started data recovery, and we were probably the first one officially, TechFusion officially started, but data recovery I got involved in around 85, 84, 86, looking into data. Back then there was nobody officially doing this. There were probably people within companies or government doing recoveries on their own. Number of projects that I have worked on, I manage projects now, projects that are not regular or it's very difficult. A few of the places that I worked with is state police. When they lost, in 2006, they lost 1.9 million 9/11 emergency calls. I worked with the Internal Revenue Service in Massachusetts. Worked for the projects for FBI. I did recovery in an international assassination case, which we were able to prove the time surveillance camera pictures were tampered with coincides with the time the police had it in their possession. So it linked the Turkish secret police in the murder of a journalist took place in Turkey. 2007, January 19, they assassinated the human rights activist, an Armenian journalist, in 2007. Other things, we also did investigation for the Middlesex Sheriff's Department. When in 2006, I believe he committed suicide, and installed hidden cameras all over the station. And about 8 years later, they asked us to do the investigation on it, and I was personally doing that. I'll tell you as I remember some other high-profile cases. Some of the projects I can't speak too much detail, but what I really like is questions. Any problems that you've had, anything, you can ask me. And this is Larry Perlmutter. He's going to go through the PowerPoint presentation. So if you have any questions for me.
You can certainly ask them when we're done. The presentation is actually on computer forensics, which is a more specialized, legal-oriented branch of data recovery. And unless someone has a desperate question, I'm happy to get started. And
turn down lights, help.
Yeah. Sure.
Does someone know how to do it?
You can also Google my name. There'll be some videos on assassination. If you put my name on assassination, you can pick up some few videos.
And you'll be amazed that he looks just as young now as he did way back then in the videos. If we can get the lights down. There we go.
Can you get the light on in the back here or something?
Yep.
There you go.
Yeah, that's good.
Okay. Digital forensics is the process of collecting, preserving, and analyzing information acquired from digital devices in a legally sound manner. I'm not going to go through every paragraph, so don't worry. I'm going to let you read as quickly as you can and just hit some of the highlights so that we can have as much time for questions and answers at the end as possible. These are some of the types of investigations that are involved. It's basically almost every aspect of any legal case, whether it's corporate, criminal, governmental, has the possibility of requiring a computer forensic aspect to any investigation, something as much as recovering lost data to something as simple as e-discovery and producing documents off, not lost, but actual documents that you have in a forensically sound manner from devices in your company. Those devices are anything from computers, as you can see, to smartphones, MP3 gaming systems. It is also possible that things off social media, whether it's internet, Instagram, Facebook, Snapchat, things of that nature. The ability of using forensics is only limited by the amount of information you can give, for example, about a Facebook. There's certain things that can be done from a public aspect, but if you are in a litigation and you get a court order and get the information from the other side as to their passwords and things of that nature, then it can get much more in depth. Again, this is the capabilities of what you can do with forensics. Again, anything from recovering deleted files to social media again, malware, spyware analysis, anything that's going on that may or may not affect whether it's someone you think someone's being hacked, or if in a divorce you think you want to track your spouse because you're not sure what they're doing, that's all possible. These are the four steps of an investigative process. Acquisition, recovery, analysis, and reporting. Acquisition is basically the preservation of whatever medium that you're basically going to be working with. A forensic image is made, if possible, because you never want to work off the actual device that is in question. Because you want, one of the keys about forensics is you want it to be reproducible and reliable. And the best way to have it be reliable is if someone else wants to come along, they can reproduce what you've done. Sure.
I know that this tool that we use in our company to make a permanent record of a computer is an imaging program like Acronis. Is that the kind of tool that you're talking about that you use when you do this?
There are other tools. I mean, they do the same thing. It's basically what they find it popular, not the hard drive. So to get the deleted files overwritten is very difficult, but it's doable.
We can't hear that.
Sorry. we use hardware and software. We can do the bit-by-bit copying, so we make a image of the drive. Usually, if you use forensic software, the forensic software has its own built-in software to do the bit-by-bit image. But there are other things in the industry that you can use.
Does something like Acronis
that takes an image, basically a snapshot of the drive, which can then be recreated on another drive or another system. Does that capture everything, or does it leave some stuff behind?
I'm not familiar with this software. To define a snapshot, do you mean bit-by-bit copying, even the deleted section? If that's what it does, then
no,
it
it's...
It has an option for that. You can choose to.
Yeah, it's technically...
I would try it. I would, every software, I would try it and see if it works before...
Well, that's almost... Well, I'm not sure how you would measure that if... to know whether or not you're picking up the deleted files. The software that you're using that does the bit-by-bit, is that something... Is that something you developed, or is that something that's commercially available?
It is available, expensive, but there are some other things. We write codes.
What is that program?
You can use Encase, you can use FPK. These are forensic softwares.
The critical thing is when you're, it's not truly a copy, as you're saying, it's a bit-by-bit copy, but the critical thing is you cannot change the original drive in any way. You change the date or you change anything, and you're vulnerable from a legal point of view in being able to prove that it's the original data. So however you're getting the data to something else, you cannot do anything.
That is correct, and when we do the forensic image, you do not change any of the metadata, any of the timestamps.
I guess I'm wondering, how do you establish to your people?
You don't need to establish that if you use a software already approved by the court.
There are actually softwares that are generally accepted in the forensic community, so another expert will know what you're doing, because that's part of a forensic report that you get to in the reporting aspect of this presentation. And when they look and see what you've done, they'll know. They'll know about what you've used, whether or not that software is actually the most up-to-date and accurate in terms of doing a bit-by-bit imaging, whether it's going to organize it properly. And if they question it, then they're going to want to have access to the original device. They're going to do their own bit-by-bit imaging, and they're going to question it.
Usually, if there's two sides to a legal lawsuits, everybody tries to hire their own forensic people. If there is, if we have to write codes like the assassination case, we have to explain what we did, but certain parts we will not. If the technology is high, the court will accept it usually. I have been an expert witness in different number of times, but usually when we give the report itself is the evidence. They don't ask us to be an expert witness. You first, sorry.
I'm intrigued by the special copy programs, the standard Unix Linux tool for doing a bit-by-bit complete copy.
That's
DD.
DD, that's correct.
It's free, it's been around about 15 years, it's bulletproof. Is there anything that's better?
You just have to try it as time goes on. The technology changes.
Does anything do anything different than that?
On the spinning drive, no, but on SSD, I cannot tell you. We do provide the erasure verification on SSD drive for large companies. It's a different service than forensic. Technology is changing.
We use it regularly on SSDs.
Well, the current SSDs, the future, I don't know what it is. But we'll see.
Just to answer some other people's questions about why your cars wouldn't work in parallel.
Why what?
Why Acronis, this Russian software, the Mac Store gives
can you
and Seagate give it to you free, it's Mac's class. Western Digital has a Western Digital. It's one thing, when everybody was moving from 512 byte sectoring to 204A, which is a cluster size for most people anyway, they wanted to make bigger things. You had to align it properly because Microsoft had misaligned things originally, and the whole industry was mad at Microsoft that they couldn't say anything rude, but eventually they had software so they could sell you these bigger 4096 sector drives, but you had to align things with XP to do it, and then all the newer versions line up properly. But the key is that the tails, the last buffer in the file, has all kinds of wonderful stuff in it. It might be from a previous file there that's never cleaned out. And very incriminating evidence. I assume you can tell us all kinds of stories about that. I worked for a company where a forensic person caused a lot of trouble for one of our staff members in federal court because it had not been properly wiped. So something like eraser, you can go and erase tails on everything on the drive. CC Cleaner, I think, does it, but I've never used CC Cleaner for that kind of purpose. But there's a lot of information on the drive that is not pointed to as that's a file in this directory or whatever else. It's just sitting there from when you delete something, it isn't deleted, it isn't expunged, it's just removed from a directory, and it's right there ready for anybody to read.
Which leads us to our current slide on recovery, which I don't have to detail because you just explained that, the detailed analysis. It can get, what you're talking about in terms of deleted, but not properly or completely erased, is in with its forensic called unallocated space. And that's where, unless it's overwritten, which CC Cleaner does, I think if you go to CC Cleaner.
It can be the end of a part of a real file, but it's the last thing which is no data beyond. But this much cryptographic disk, but they don't want it here, and the rest of that particular thing is very incriminating.
Or if that part on that out of that drive is deleted, but the computer then fills in these other areas, we can still get that part that was deleted, even though you think you've properly deleted it. CC Cleaner actually will do that because if you set it, it'll overwrite once, it'll overwrite seven times, and it's the overwriting, to be clear, of that allocated space. That's what makes it not, if it's overwritten enough, it makes it impossible to recover. If it's overwritten once, then people like Alfred are able to then still piece it together. But if it's continually overwritten that same exact spot,
it's like an eraser type program will ask you how many passwords do you want to use, the British standards or the NSA standards, and which ones do you want, and you want zeros, ones, or random.
Exactly.
And you want arbitrary random text left there, so it isn't obvious this thing was at its tail screen.
Basically, overwriting gets rid of the deleted files. I don't know if any of you follow the Patriots. Last time I was on TV in news, NBC, New York Times, was Tom Brady's cell phone. Mm-hmm. He brought it like a caveman. All he had to do was fill up the plate. He fill up the cell phone with videos.
But of course, that's not as much fun.
You folks have a standing electron microscope that can read the disk by scanning?
We can, yes.
Do you have one, or?
Yes, in a different lab. We don't do that much, unless it's a special project.
So
we have done physically overwritten recovery. Basically, when you say overwritten, because it's a stepper motor, it doesn't line, it does not land exactly on the same square. So there's always a residue.
Yeah, on the edges.
We can pick up. That's why they say two times, three times, four times, five times. Any hard drive that you cannot recover the data now, as long as it's not scraped or scratched heavy, to peel off the chemical that holds the charges that translates to the data, later in future, equipment will be easier and available and cheaper to access.
Can I ask the Gutman question? So you guys know about this Gutman method, the 35 passes? And the story I heard was just ridiculous. Like three passes is plenty to make things safe. But is there any merit to what you're choosing in one of these eraser programs, to choosing more than three passes? Is there any to protect from your finding the data? Does it really make any difference?
Well, if it's somebody that did a robbery in a big bank and he never wants to be caught, maybe 35 is good for him. Or not anybody that can recover one pass or two pass.
That's really helpful to know because
people do come and ask us for erasure. Some people have it their business. I'm not an expert at that. Their business is certain things they do. I didn't ask them, but they only need to keep the IRS papers for 3 years. And they want it to be deleted the next morning, like at 12 o'clock midnight. They're like, wow, why not, another day? So they're very precise on the data curation.
If you're not dealing with a hard drive, which is, they've been around for decades, they're in known object, they just get bigger. But services, the Tumblr, the Grindr, the Twitter, the Facebook, all of those things where have the tools kept up with these flurry of social network apps? Or do you have to go subpoena shopping?
Subpoena has become more difficult. Google was easier. You know, you send a subpoena, they would respond. Now they don't. You have to send a motion after subpoena, get a lawyer to go there, you know, to get this. But as long as you have the hardware, you go back to the same thing, bit by bit, go through the hardware, do the conversion, and all that.
And I'm presuming, say, that I'm not doing a legal or high profile recovery, but maybe just the office wants to see what they can find on this guy, or as a parent, I want to see what I can find on my kid.
That's
interesting. or my kid's boyfriend.
I'm thinking how you can do it for your kid. How old is your kid? We do get calls.
23 and 24.
Don't you think they're about the limit of you getting into their business?
They are, until they come and say that I have to spend the weekend fixing their computer because they broke it.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Legally, we won't be able to help you out. Come to us, and it's owned by your son. We need their approval or their signature, especially if you do not have the password. We will not break the password.
The anti-hacking laws have gotten a lot, are slowly catching up, and both on state and federal level, protecting that even if you buy your 24-year-old a phone and it's on your family account, you can't hack into that phone. So if you brought that phone to us without his written authorization, his or hers, son or daughter, God bless you, we would not be able to do any recovery on that phone. And we've actually had that in divorce cases where spouses are trying to, they want the GPS location that's automatic on some phones. Where did my spouse go on this particular day at this particular time? And we can't do it, not without their being their own phone.
If you want to do it, you know, this is how you do it. You have to be using your son's computer or whoever else at home, family. Use it for your personal or business use. You can prove that this is the case.
In other words, like a family computer versus someone's individual, or even a family phone, this is the phone that whoever family is going out, they use it, but multiple users are on it.
What about a computer with several accounts on the device?
You cannot go to each account.
If they're password protected, if they're not password protected, you can go. But if they're password protected, it's hacking.
Wait, so let me understand. If there's a computer and somebody comes to me and says, Adam, this guy I'm having this conflict with left this computer in my office. I want to know all about him. And the guy didn't password the computer.
Did not.
Do I have
a office? In my office, it belongs to the company.
Maybe he left it on the sidewalk. I mean, my question is, as a computer professional, where do I have to say, no, I have to have this guy's
account? We had a case. This is what I can tell you. We had a case, a medical case, that the ambulance forgot the computer on a tire, on their car tire. And somebody calls and says, we found the computer, we saw the computer. The whole computer is in pieces. And you can tell somebody robbed it down, you know, on the asphalt, but the hard drive had no scratch on it, nothing. So it is illegal, you know, it's a HIPAA compliance, and they have to sign a paper that none of this information will appear anywhere, and if it does, we will put you in jail.
As I said, the hacking laws are fairly recent and they're catching up slowly, but the law is one thing, with the courts, how they'll interpret it. So if somebody brings you a computer and says, no, this is my computer, and then signs an authorization, right now you're probably covered, but if you then find something improper on that computer, you may have a mandatory reporting requirement. And it's, I'm sorry?
Like,
Like if you have child pornography on it, you have an absolute reporting requirement that you need to stop whatever you're doing, call the police, turn it over. Mm-hmm. At which point, since you don't know whose it is, any equipment that's in your office that may or may not have had some electronic contact, they might seize for their investigation. And when you get it back from the government, you'll get it back. They're not seizing it. But
when is the question?
When? And is that
significant? And if they determine that because of what you've done, you should have known and you shouldn't have done this, that's what I'm saying. The interpretation of the laws hasn't quite gotten there. Cases haven't filtered through to give guidance. So at this point, it's interpretation. One prosecutor said, Bill Cosby shouldn't be prosecuted. The other one is prosecuting him on exactly the same thing. So what might not be improper today, a year from now, we don't know.
Well, look at what happened to Scalia, whether he was suiciding or murdered by his friends. One way or the other, the FBI agent sent the top of the Justice Department to the White House, and it was pedophilia on a global scale, and it was touching household names around the world. Go to Veterans Day and hear about it. VeteransDay.com. It was really bad, and that's what happened. But mainstream media won't touch it.
You meant to start with NASA and recovering data from crash franchise. Is that something that you see a lot now? I'm asking because I have a daughter who's part of a crash.
Literally, like, crash on the floor?
Yes, it stopped working and would not respond.
Well, they recreated an environment for high altitude, low pressure, so they were installed in a case.
Okay.
So the crash was not breaking the hard drive, but as long as the plates are not as great, there's a way to get to it.
Okay, so if the spindle is going out and it simply stopped turning?
Spindle doesn't matter. As long as the plates are not removed, we can get it. Even the plates are removed, but that's very expensive.
Yes.
Certainly. Yeah. Well, it's all connected, but the most important aspect, or I should say the flip side of going after something that may be deleted or anything else, is if you need something preserved, or if you've accidentally deleted something of your own, or for you're in litigation and you need to get something, the bottom paragraph is very important because, again, as we were talking about, the more it's overwritten, the more you use a device, whether it's a phone or a computer, the greater chance that space that you need is going to be overwritten and you're going to lose what you need. So, for example, if you have a phone, you place it in airplane mode, power it off, lock it away until you get it to us or another forensic investigator, because the more you use it, and I've got to tell you, we have people who are walking and going, I lost something on my phone, can you get it for me, as they're using it, and texting it and talking, and they've been using it for the last 2 weeks.
There's
still a chance, but will they get everything they want? Because forensically, because remember, when you do that bit-by-bit image, you might not get an entire text, an entire image, but you can still get fragments. And whether or not you get enough to actually piece together, you know, substantially, that's also a possibility.
What about leaving the computer on versus shutting it down?
Or what?
Just leaving it on because you're afraid that if you power it back up again, it's either not going to boot up or it's going to overwrite something or
that
crash
happened,
something.
That happened in electromechanical products. It happens more. That was a bigger case like in the 90s. It's
okay.
A little less now.
Well, specific to that point, typically if you're talking about a criminal situation and the police walk into it, they won't shut the machine off, they'll pull the plug out. Because as I say, the critical thing is you can't change anything on the hard drive. Sometimes Windows, when you're shutting down, it's writing things and deleting things.
Just paging files.
That's the point. They just pull the plug because otherwise you can't. And I'll also point out, when you're examining the hard drive, don't think to turn the machine on and you're examining it then. They remove the hard drive and it's the second drive of the machine. You're booting it up with a different drive because, as I say, you turn on the machine and you're going to be changing some of the files.
Which brings up another question. Doesn't shutting, just pulling the plug on the computer, crash the drive?
Doesn't physically crash it.
No.
It does crash, it may most likely will crash it software-wise, so you cannot boot it up. And since it's a forensic, you don't need to boot it up. You just put it on the slate.
I should think that if I were trying to catch it with the best recoverable data, I'd keep it running. Because it's encrypted and has a password, those are running right now until I turn it off.
There are certain viruses, there are certain things out there that when you turn it off, and then we try to turn it back on, the power to it erases.
I should think I'll try to come along with a battery and keep it going.
But I definitely agree with your point, which is that if you steal a computer that's running, especially laptops and batteries now, your ability to get access to stuff, especially if the person doesn't lock the machine when they walk away from it,
that's the next phase.
Is considerable.
Okay. Modern operating system is always scribbling all kinds of strange things you're running and doing things, and those are messing up with data.
The next stage in a forensic investigation is the analysis, which is after the acquisition and recovery. This is when the investigator steps in as doing more personal time versus computer time. And this slide and this slide will basically explain pretty much what they're doing and how they examine. Sometimes the software that is used forensically will not only acquire it, but organize it to make it easier to analyze. And that's familiarity with the tools, and the better, more familiar you are with it, the better you can use it to find what it is you're looking for. Last is reporting. That's, for the most part, self-explanatory. You're creating a report, but the very important part, as was talked about before by Alfred, why do you not need the expert witness to come in and actually talk about the report? Because if the report is properly done and properly self-verifying by the methodology that you use and the tools that you use, another expert's going to look at it and go, no, they did it right. There's no reason to question this, okay? Because of how they did it and how it's presented in the report.
It's like a cop and it establishes a chain of custody.
Yeah, unless the, what you're doing is unique, then you have to, they may ask you to go.
Process you to accomplish what steps.
They'll ask you what steps you've taken.
If you're writing new code, proprietary code that's doing something that's not out there yet, you need to do something more cutting edge than just like most scientific aspects.
Sometimes we do go against the other forensic people, and two times we went against the FBI. Once they asked me to evaluate the forensic person of the FBI, the other one FBI wanted to put this person in jail, and the data they had was not right, and they presented a different hard drive serial number. We don't know if it was on purpose or not. They just said that we're not going to, continue on this case.
What's in the news nowadays is the National Bank of Bangladesh, which lost $81 million. If you got that as a case, how would you go using forensic to figure out what happened?
First thing to do is get the server where the outside network comes in, and then hire the best security person to give us the information on his expertise, then take all the information, have a good team, best of every case, and see what happens. It's
what would you do, go into the backups? I assume they have daily backups at the bank.
Backup is one, but the network setup is more important.
Because what you're talking about
also
is how did they get access to the system to be able to utilize it? Because they didn't really, it wasn't a virus that they, for the most part, they basically got in and utilized the internal system in a manner that wasn't obvious to the people who were monitoring it, or they had inside information and knew how to get around that.
Go ahead. It could also be internal.
Yeah. So I mean, basically,
that doesn't even know, puts a USB that's already infected or sold brand new. They can just hang it into a store. You just buy it.
I'm trying to get a sense that you'll get hired either by the prosecution or defense, you know, to present the case in behalf of that party. And if you use standard devices and standard practices, as you say, that your presentation, as you see it, is, I don't know if irrefutable is the right term.
That's correct.
But by the same token, you're going to be opposing another side who's going to have their own expert. So on one hand, how can they accept your findings and still bring a case in it's opposition?
It's up to them. I mean, they if the judge, let's say this person has, let's pick an example.
I mean, would
let's
they accept your process but refute your analysis and reporting, or what would they, how would they refute?
Possibly it goes into, you see someone standing in the doorway of this room. One person says that means they're coming out. Another person says, no, that doesn't mean they're coming out, because you picked a criminal spot where it's beyond proof, beyond a reasonable doubt. So the evidence collected is the person standing in the doorway. What does it mean? What, and that's where, for the one limitation of forensics and any other type of computer analysis, you can't prove who's actually behind the keyboard. Okay, so you can say what happened on the computer, what it did, where it connected to, but who's behind it, you can't. And that's where the two sides might have an argument. Is it more likely than not, because the bad thing that was done on this computer, they entered the bank, 1 second, at 10 o'clock. At 9:58, this person entered their password, logged on to something and went through their regular accounts, did some emails. At 10:02, they did the same thing. What is the probability that someone else used this computer in between that 1 minute time?
Okay.
And that's the type of thing where you start getting into, they both have the same data, but what does it mean? And what is the likelihood based upon not just that what happened at 10 o'clock, but what happened in the computer and surrounding aspects to it? And you might have different things saying, you know what, in that 1 minute time, he was open, the computer was open, somebody could have accessed and hacked into his computer and utilized his computer, and it wasn't him doing it.
Mm-hmm. Part of that question, wouldn't part of that be keyboarding style? Word phrasing?
What's the question?
The short answer is yes. I mean, that's what you'd have. It might go beyond the simple forensics in terms of word styling and phraseology. You might be getting slightly more into psychological or almost the equivalent of a handwriting expert in those types of things.
It depends
how much information and data they're able to provide. Because you can't compel, for example, the defendant, and we're working for the prosecution.
Yeah, because there's...
You can't compel them to give their computing style.
Well, it's either a high school or a college student, just on the news the other night, she developed a security protocol for smartphones that engages, or actually disengages, if the person who owns the phone, when they pick it up, it interprets how they handle the phone.
Yeah, which stinks if you give it to your kid or your spouse or your friend to use your phone, and all of a sudden it locks up on you and you lose everything.
If I can interrupt a minute and
sure.
Put my lawyer's hat on and also having taught digital forensics, don't confuse the issue of the forensics collection of the digital information and the interpretation and the presentation of what it means.
Exactly.
You guys are getting into the argument, which is what lawyers are paid to do, is to
depending on the case, we will choose which forensic person is best for this case. If you have a forensic psychologist or work as a forensic psychologist, help her to a forensic psychologist doctor, and we do need some interpretation of our level. Now the legal side will have their own. We can help. If this is what he or she thinks, she can write it that this is my interpretation and pass it on based on these evidence. And then the attorney can do whatever they want. We will not alter, change based on what the attorney wants.
But that's the interpretation of the digital page you've retrieved.
Correctly.
Which is
correct.
Different than how do you forensically acquire that data and maintain
that is correct. But one of the things that we do as investigators, or that our investigators do, is in fact determining, did the other side's investigator follow proper protocol in terms of how they handled the equipment, how they extracted the data, preserved it, going through the four steps. And of course, every investigator as an expert is going to make an opinion as to what that data, where it leads. And there could be differences of opinion depending on how solid the data is or isn't, which is why reports are often sufficient for attorneys to make their case, and they don't require people, because there is a, for lack of a better term, a slam dunk. This is what it was, this is how we did it, this is what it came out to be. Okay, and every other expert, if they're gonna do it right and be honest and be credible, is gonna come out exactly the same result. It is on this computer, this is what was there, this is what we found, which is more acquisition, it's less interpretation. Yes, the further you get into the interpretation, the more that's where the lawyers are going to be at play versus the forensic investigators.
With the prevalence of solid-state drives, is it more difficult? Is there different technology that you have to use for recovering the data? Does it wipe the data differently than a spinning drive does?
I'm really concerned about this question, and just a very practical level. We have customers that have solid-state drives. What's safe in dealing with them after the customer is done with them? Is it kind of related?
We do erasure verification for certain companies. EMC, and other companies. They sell equipment, big storage boxes to government, financial institutions, medical institutions. So they use a software to erase the whole SSD, if I may draw it over here. And we're supposed to say that this software works perfectly with this SSD hard drive. One of the things about SSD is that, let's say if they make a 100 gigabyte SSD, usually the company makes extra space. These currently or a little before have 1200 read and write. It may change as time goes on. Now there's a new technology coming, whole new technology on SSD. They have three states, not two states. Every cell. So when the cells get old, it replaces it, or let's say it blocks it and it replaces with a new one. Now when you do a wipe, it does not access here. So they ask us to take all the chips out and read every chip. Now we have to organize and see how the information was written, you know, what was written here, what was written here. And we have to translate it, see if it's a readable data or not. So I think as time goes on the cell phones, you'll have the same technology, similar technology, but everybody would use their own algorithm, and they're very protective of those algorithms. We are working on those algorithms to see if we can break or not. The case that there was in California, we really, I was personally very interested to see if we can get that. We didn't, FBI did it some other way. I personally think the government can do it themselves. Maybe they made a case so that they can get other things from Apple, or they want to tell all the legal people Apple is safe, go ahead, do whatever you want. You have no access to that data.
But early in the presentation, we spoke about spinning hard drives, right, and we had discussions about the number of writes that can successfully overwrite an area. We spoke in terms of the head not being perfectly aligned, so the size of the track had residuals of the old. That doesn't exist in SSD. So why would not a single write or a single overwrite of SSD, if there's no residual,
actually,
be good enough?
Actually, the world is analog, not digital. It exists here, but it's very small. It's almost undoable. But if you do a wipe, this area is a provision.
Well, I understand the area. I'm talking about the bulk of the device.
Yeah, you can do wipe because this area. Yeah.
So I don't understand. When they invented this device, they weren't thinking about this fundamental issue of the ability to zap all.
when you sell this device, you're selling it to companies, right? These SSDs. And one of the first thoughts you should have is, how are they going to wipe it? And so they didn't program into this a simple code that would simply wipe all the cells?
They do have that algorithm, but they don't use it.
Well, the company that's preparing it,
the company manufacturer, what are they thinking?
They can wipe it because they have the algorithm that can access that other area. They're not willing to share it.
Why?
Like a standard, you buy a standard encrypted hard drive, and that thing can be erased just like that. Once that thing's flushed, you can't go in. The data's all there, but you don't have any way of encrypting it.
Well, Adam, in the
that's kind of a secondary.
That's different from this.
Think about it this way.
In the old world, you're wrong. It wasn't the first thing they thought of, it was the last thing they thought of. Really, that was the...
If you can't guarantee that that's erased, then you've got to destroy it and buy a new one instead of being able to reuse it.
Thank you. That's the explanation.
And to go one step further, the manufacturers that I deal with in the past couple of years, all the way down to the warranty level, now have programs of driving attention. So if your computer is under warranty and it crashed, they'll honor the warranty while still allowing you to retain the hard drive as part of the warranty.
But then you have to take a drill to it, right?
Regardless, they are now finally, after all these years, understanding and respecting the concept that you want to protect your data and you don't trust anybody to have it out of your hands. And that's only the last year or two that I've seen this.
The secret sauce behind a lot of the solid state drives is that you can, it used to be for the two bit per cell, it was about 50,000 writes, I think it was, and that cell committing suicide. Huh? And the single bit per cell, the higher end drives, would be 100,000. I was talking to a Japanese company at the Embedded System Conference, the Convention Center, not that many weeks ago, and it's really not 50 anymore because everything's gotten smaller, everything. It's really 30,000. But aside from that, the secret sauce that makes it work is in their controller and their microcode in there. They do this wearable leveling algorithm, so even if you keep erasing the same file and writing it or something like it, same size, same place, it's not necessarily going to the same place on the disk. They're moving the wear around by whatever thinking things they're doing, so that the drive will last a long time. They spread the grief as much as they can.
See, now what I found...
But it's more than that. I have a crucial drive, a higher end one. When you write at extremely high speed, it switches, because its writing is normally slower than by a bit. It switches from double bit mode to single bit mode. So it's taking more cells, but your data is getting in at the higher speed when things get backed up. And then when things quiet down, it goes and pushes them all into two bit cells. So some of this other stuff is sitting there in other pieces. It's really complex, and I wish you guys luck if you run into that.
See, what I was going to answer to that, it wasn't the concept of the drive. What I'm finding is the major manufacturers have families of SSDs that have different price, different performance, and different longevities, and now they're tailoring it to the type of use. It's asking you how you're going to use it.
There isn't one simple answer. They optimize for the thing.
Exactly.
Some of the tech experts out there publishing online or in magazines say, oh, this drive is weird because it's got this weird graph. Well, the weird graph is because they're doing this optimization. When they go to single bit mode, they can write screamingly faster than the double bit mode, and then they go back and pack it in double bit mode later. But that gives it some weird speed curves when they run these volatile tests on them.
Go ahead.
What about the cache or prefetch on a hard drive, especially when it's SSD? Okay, so you've erased the drive, but you've still got the cache.
When you typically use
the SSD, especially SSD cache.
On the hard drive or on the system?
Well, for that matter, both.
If it's a...
They typically use it dynamic on the SSD because there is no latency. So they usually eliminate the cache.
Depends on the hard drive, you have to read the specs. How they designed it, if they wanted to.
You need a big cache because your SAS cable can run faster than the dry can. You want to take advantage of bursting stuff over and letting the drive chew on it, so you get 128.
On a spinning drive?
On the those drives.
But I guess
just a
follow-up.
Just a practical question, Alfred. We have more and more customers who are buying machines with SSDs.
Correct.
When it's time to move on to the next machine and the machine gets donated or disposed of, it sounds to me like the prudent thing to do is to destroy the drive, and that's really the only thing.
You can, but keep in mind, in this area, a lot of data is little pieces.
Yeah.
It may be helpful for forensics, but I don't think you'll get a good solid data that's
reasonable. So for common sense purposes, I'm thinking, let's imagine.
I would do this erase, and most likely it should be okay, unless it's military or.
Okay, so for a customer that's like running a law firm or something, that feels like it would be up to standard to run an eraser.
Yeah,
that
if they hold a computer for 3 years, the SSD price is so low, just wait it, have it.
Just destroy it?
Yeah, and if you want to donate it, got to put a brand new SSD drive in that doesn't have anything on it, and donate the computer.
But the drive itself, you recommend physically destroying, like running a drill through it or something.
If you have attorney-client privilege stuff on your law firm, do you know the liability or a hospital? Is it worth the cost of an SSD drive to risk that even a little bit of information could come out and come back at you, violating your duty to keep it secure, whether you're a hospital or a law firm? It's not worth it.
Okay.
Go ahead.
So, in the beginning, you talked about the case that you had with videos.
One meeting, please.
Issues. Can you just describe how different it is to investigate video information versus data, regular data?
Should I put the video on from the YouTube?
No, that's not what he's asking.
I have another video.
I think he's asking, I'm not sure that is a difference if it's on a computer. You're going after the same, where it's stored and everything else, whether it's a video, a photograph, or data. It's all stored in a similar manner.
Digital data, databases, videos.
Or are you talking about actually like trying to recover a videotape?
I don't know what your case is.
There is a YouTube case. If you type my name, you can pick it up. I specifically talk about the assassination. You know what was done. I also show samples, and we recover the pictures that dots are missing. So when you recover something like that on a video, if it's 20 pictures per frame, you don't need all 20 pictures. You can recover 5 pictures, 10 pictures, and in every section you may miss. Portions, and this one you miss this part, and the other one you miss this part, but if you put them together, it becomes as a complete picture. You can look at it on the YouTube, it may answer you, and you can call me if you have any questions. Can I give my phone number?
If you would like Alfred's card and information about Tech Fusion, there's a...
That's... Presentation?
You have to ask.
Sure. The videotape of the presentation will be available on the vino.org site, and the slides are on there.
Yes, they are.
We want you to be well known.
Slides on the slide.
I want to get your permission.
The slides are part of the video.
Where are you company based? No, you must be.
Sorry,
right near
sorry.
Fresh Pond Park.
I'm still questioning.
Fresh Pond Mall.
Examples on the blackboard. 20 years ago, probably 40 years ago,
that's
great.
Okay.
Also reallocated. You get an error code,
correct,
and swap in a different sector.
Yes.
Hidden all sections will be there until they were.
Is it email on here?
Mm-hmm. I can give
you
my individual
to erase by file. You wouldn't erase them. But if you erased by sector, for all the sectors, you would erase them. I don't see why the same doesn't hold for a solid state drive. I know they're faster. I know they're swapping smaller portions of the whole drive. And I also know we can still allocate any of those portions. So there's a way to get to them. And what's more, the end user gets to them as they get reallocated. So So whether or not I know the algorithm for which one gets allocated next, I still claim I ought to be able to erase all of them.
On the SSD, you're able to get that? On the SSD, you're able to get that?
Yes, on the SSD, I don't see why I can't just use DD to allocate every single pointer.
Try it. Try it. There are different SSDs, one for production, one for storage places, cloud. It's moving towards SSD. And a lot of companies are going to come up with new stuff, and they're going to hold on to information. So I don't know if this information you're saying will be available by then. Maybe for some older models, will be newer models now. Wait 2-3 years then.
But do you see any place on a solid state drive that DD could not access?
Yes. The part that is provisioned, they call it provision area, that only the firmware of the hard drive can access, and there's certain codes for access that enable it. So you can.
And how can DD copy all the files after some of them were sitting in some of that area?
They cannot.
Yeah, can.
Well,
the working set.
Only what's operating system is seeing the provision area. No, the only way we can access it is by physically removing the chips.
The firmware is juggling it for you. You look for
like
you're seeing,
deciding when to switch which one.
So you might be able to affect one cell in that area, but you don't have any way of going to the whole thing and writing onto it. They're using a special tool to get to that area, and it's being very frugal about which cells it makes available to the rest, to the operating system.
I'm having a lot of trouble picturing at a physical level what your special tool is doing other than deciding when to allocate. Which one?
But it's not letting you get access to all the other ones that haven't been allocated.
Well, if they haven't been allocated, why is it?
It makes change. I'm sorry.
My
it makes changes as the
firmware
gets weaker.
Our starting position on software is if you aren't constrained in some odd way by a proprietary producer, it can do anything the hardware can do. Now, my question here is, if the hardware constrained me from getting there, how the hell am I getting there after it gets switched into? I think I can, is what I'm saying. I haven't done it, but conceptually I'm not understanding a step along the way. It said it's out of
reach. It is available to get there. You can do it, reverse engineering. But every manufacturer, every model, you're going to have to try it again. It takes a while. Depends how much resources you have.
The bad block sector that gets kicked out,
or a weak,
replaced by a
weak
spare,
section.
Which has the same address now as the one that was there, but you can't get it the one that was replaced.
That's how it used to be with hard drives, too. We just have finer grain on it.
It's the old one, Dick, that's the problem. Is that right, Mark? It's the old cell that we're worried about. A cell that used to have data on it that was taken out of commission.
Yeah, I agree.
So if I can access all the cells, I can erase all the cells. But you can't access all the cells once the swap is happening. There's some cells sitting there that where it made it did some swapping and there's some stuff left there that you can't touch. It's taken out of circulation.
There are certain recoveries
we get. We need information. We can't get it from anywhere. Even if we know people within Intel, they're so secretive about it. They will not release it.
You've tried.
It's shocking. We have tried, and sometimes we really do need those information. The client is willing to pay anything. It's not available, not all of it, but it's just not available. They won't release it until they have the newer model, and then they may, after a year or 2 years, release it, because everybody is looking what the other one has to
Absolutely,
go ahead.
Yes.
Go ahead.
What I wanted to get back, there was earlier talk about the file tails, the ends of the files that don't have anything in it, that unless you go out of your way to wipe those, it could be. Would that typically be text data, part of a text document, a text versus if it's like a piece of a picture or a piece of a program?
Anything.
I mean, is it possible to piece that together and make relevance of it, or would it just be
That's some of what we do in the unallocated space. As we talked about earlier, sometimes you can't get a whole picture. You get enough of those pieces from the unallocated space.
So even if it's not just plain, numbers and letters, you can still piece together various pieces of unallocated.
Electronic data is electronic data.
You can look at a picture in YouTube. I explain an explanation. It says assassination. There is a picture there that you see blocks are not taken out. It doesn't make sense.
But to me, it's like confetti. If it's all unallocated, what's the process, the time, which pieces go together to make the final picture?
Go to your shredder.
Yeah.
You can recreate every document in there if you have enough time. And
enough Iranian students in the MC.
Jigsaw puzzle.
Yes.
So it is.
That's why cross-cut shredders were invented.
Yes.
Not surprisingly, the conversations have been focused on the real nitty-gritty technical stuff. But in terms of forensics, once you retrieve the data, you guys get involved actually looking for embedded information in a normal text file, in a picture, and all the other kinds of places that you can have
Usually they ask us, they give us search criteria, time or person or this. We say we have 1,000 of these. These are the regular cases. On specific cases that somebody really wants us to get into it, we do do it.
I think the fancy word is what? Stenography or something like that, where you're embedding code or information within a picture, and you're just messing around with the lower bits of every fourth byte or something like that. And there are programs that try to recreate that, but I was just curious.
Something like that, maybe
to
get
it's part of spygraph.
10 years.
Yeah. That's not the normal case. Your normal case is they give a search criteria. We search for it, whether it's embedded or not. If someone wanted to hide a love letter in a divorce case inside, another document, we looking through keywords, we might be able to pull out what they wanted. But you're talking about something even more embedded.
Yeah.
That's not a normal case. Is it something we could do?
Yes, I believe it is, but we'd have to be commissioned to do it. I mean, it's not something we would normally do as part of a standard forensic. It's not looking for things like that. The purpose is goal-oriented. This is what you're looking for. We acquire the image, the bit-by-bit image, then we look for what you've instructed us to look for.
In your non-hardware, non-technical, in your experience, have you hit places where your ethics say you won't go there, even when the police or whoever say you're allowed to and they're paying you to?
I have.
Our company has.
You can describe? This is very interesting to me. The more powerful we get, the more invasive we get. So.
We had a case. A father comes in and says, my daughter just turned 18 and has $80,000 cash. This is my wife, I have to answer. It is.
I'll continue. Different story. Because it's a different example.
Unless his wife calls you.
Well, my wife calls me. Sorry. This was a discussion about power.
So, okay.
So the father comes to us and says, the daughter up with somebody in this sad case that was 15, 16 years old with a guy, and then she waited till she's 18 and she is doing prostitution.
She was what?
Doing prostitution. So he came to us, the first phone he had the password, and we did look at it. it, and he said, I got another phone, but she's not willing to give me the password. So I didn't say anything. There was an attorney from us there and another person for a week, and they both said that we can't do this. It's a federal offense or whatever. Mm-hmm. So I called the father up. I said, just come in. Just talk to me. I just did it for him. Not any papers. Sorry.
Because she was over 18.
No, because of what the father was doing. He was going to every door that he found, knocking on the door, talking to the people, and the professors at MIT, Harvard, lawyers, attorney, mm-hmm. head of a law firm.
I guess my point is, because the daughter was over 18, she's no longer a minor.
Correct.
She has privacy Sorry. Issues. If she was under 18, she could have probably more rights than the father.
Correct. So I try not to be judgmental on cases, but something like that, I just
Even in that area where you're talking where it's a minor, what if the parents don't agree on the proceeding?
Oh, there are a lot of issues.
Then it becomes very dicey, because if you do it because dad says yes and mom finds out, she's now suing you on behalf of her child for invasion of privacy.
Oops. Mm-hmm. Well,
it's a very difficult aspect.
You were going to offer an example?
No, it was just a different example. Again, it dealt with a divorce and potential for child pornography, and whether or not, and we actually had
a witch hunt trip.
I'm sorry?
A witch hunt trip?
No, it actually was not a witch hunt trip, but an attorney who represented one side said, no, this is not pornography. And we actually made a decision that said we didn't agree with the attorney and we did not go forward. We didn't even get to square one based on the possibility. It might not have been, and again, how is it interpreted, and state law versus federal law? One might say no, one might say yes. Either way, we didn't want to get anywhere near that. Even something that close to the borderline, even when an attorney says, no, this isn't. It's okay to look at this. We didn't even start the investigation. We didn't take anything in against
it. Neither of these are quite getting to what I was wondering about.
Okay.
You're saying you feel you may be exposing yourself because of conflicting interpretations, so you back off. I wonder about one where you're not exposing yourself, you just think you should back off anyway. Do you get those?
I just want to add to what I said. When I did this was over 8 years ago, the legal words were not as solid as now.
Mm-hmm. It's almost impossible when you're talking to answer your question because it's logically inconsistent. Okay?
I didn't follow the reason.
You're asking, where are our ethics coming from? If it was perfectly legal to kill somebody.
I'm asking you whether you find you have ethics that conflict with the lawful request that you're being asked.
We have, I don't know if this answers your question or not. We have cases, we had a case we received and they wanted us to do forensic work and they wouldn't to pay a lot of money. It was a shock and not a thing, we basically told them that.
The way where you have to draw the legal line for this, and obviously you have to know your rights and where you stand and what all the laws are, the difference between being approached, you mentioned the FBI or local police, does that imply that what's brought to you is at least brought up to a legal point that they had the right search warrants or whatever, so it's not your responsibility to analyze the legality versus if I came to you with this computer, now you've perhaps got to work harder in making sure that I'm legally, what I'm presenting to you is legal versus police, what they present. I'm not sure I asked that right.
You have to do your due diligence.
If it's anything illegal, we won't.
Right.
Or we have cases that people come and, if we feel that it's being unfair to her,
right.
If we have have to break.
I mean, as a business person, like, we can always say no.
Break
for whatever.
Like, we get divorce cases.
We can say
cases.
No to the police also.
Right.
We get divorce cases that usually the woman is really harassed, mentally and computer-wise. Being hacked, being this, that. So cases like that, we make exceptions, not all the time. But most cases like that, when we take it, maybe 10, 12 cases like that, they don't have to pay a lot, and we just take care of it.
What's your ratio of individuals' approach for personal things versus law enforcement?
Okay, a lot comes from lawyers, so we can't tell it's individual, they represent an individual or a company. But direct companies, maybe a few a month.
I'm not sure if you're asking more how many are civil cases versus criminal cases. We get actually more civil cases than we do criminal cases. Unfortunately, a lot of defendants can't afford to pay for a forensic investigation that will rival that of the state. And the state, and the state's actually, the state police has their own forensic investigation unit.
I believe.
And so they actually have in-house people. So they do come to us more on the civil side than the criminal side, but we also do work on the criminal side for the state.
We did, I mean, you can read on our website, we did a recovery for state police, 1.9 million 911 emergency calls. After that, every time they came to us, they asked for the sign of paper not to talk about it. That one, they sent me a paper saying that NDA, that you cannot talk about what you've done in the past, now, or the future. And then, so I said, you know, I may be speaking with an accent, but I don't think with one. I'll sign off. I'll sign whatever working on right now. He said, we're giving you a big contract. I said, only give us when you can't do it. Nobody else can do it. So said, just sign something and send it to us.
One of my questions is, what is your competition like? Like, how does it? How do you feel? How do you fit into a larger scheme of not being been here for a long, long time?
His wife.
Yeah, so I gotta take it because it's his wife. Okay.
I just talked to my husband. It's now time for you to talk to yours.
Competition is different. We do work with competition. Sometimes we're ahead of the competition writing software, depends on what has come to us. Sometimes we could be behind, you know, 2 weeks, 1 month. If they only worked on SSD, 1,000 SSDs, and we worked on 100 SSDs, of course they may have a little more software than we do. There are other companies, they follow this pack of forensic, they dump everything on a hard drive, and they give you permission to access. Let's say, this site can only access certain files, they give you the right to access it and do the search yourself for law firms. So they don't really do forensic work. If they require to do forensic work, they'll go ahead and do it. Some have this path, some have other businesses that they make duplicate of everything, every traffic, every website, Facebook, everything onto another server. So when you need an employee is making a lawsuit or you want to try to get rid of them, you want to know the history, you go to the archives and you pick it up from there.
How do you charge? How do you set a price?
We charge $250 an hour, and when somebody comes, we give them an estimate of how much this would be. We charge a consulting fee, $350, whether it takes 1 hour, usually less 2 hours or more. There'll be one or two people. We listen to the case. First, we sign a non-disclosure agreement that anything they tell us stays with us. And just in the middle, some people did this to us. They come to us, they pay $350, they sign a paper so that the other opposition cannot hire us. And they don't hire us, they do this. We had a law firm that about five times they went again, they were on the opposite side, they lost. So what they do now is anytime there's an opposition, they tell them, we're working with them and there's a conflict of interest. And even if you try to prove that someone, there's a slight chance of losing, they'll go somewhere else. But they do, this law firm does do this. I change the subject.
No.
Sorry.
No, not at all. Thank you. That's interesting.
Go ahead.
In a situation where there's documents that were on a cloud server, Google, Facebook,
We do
something like that, how do you go in and recover that data? Because it's just a section of this massive hard drive that's being shared by thousands of people.
We need password permission to get on.
People
have gone in to get court orders to get access to other people's social media, other people's cloud accounts, things of that nature. If it's for their own client, then and they want to see what's there and preserve it for possibly because it's exculpatory information or information that proves it supports their side, then they'll give us that permission.
I think you're asking a slightly different question.
Yeah, how do you recover the data from a piece of a hard drive that's being shared by thousands of people? I'm not talking about the legal ramifications.
Okay.
I'm talking about the technical ramifications.
Are you assuming that we have the hard drive?
No, Google has it.
For example,
Facebook.
Section we get, and that's the only section we get.
We don't go to the server. We're basically limited to that aspect that we can get with the password and the username and that type of information.
So
we can't get to the server.
There's a physical space
we cannot recover the deleted files if they do.
It's not a bit like
no.
So this is really, I think, worth noting it because it's, I think it's a really nice way also wrapping up this discussion about new data recovery, which is that we're now using, a lot of our customers are using, a space over which Alfred has no physical control and never can. And I think it's really important to note that. Because look at what he's done for the last 30 years in being able to get physical control. And now so many people are giving up physical control over their data. We need to be thinking very carefully about the consequences of that.
And they're not very smart. There are companies that are doing their own storage, and it is the same as being on a cloud. So when something breaks like that, they bring us the whole hard drive with 200 hard drives. They'll bring it to us. There are data centers that have crashed and they have to bring everything.
So
they will.
No,
we
need
to
cover
the data.
I'm sorry.
It
fits together. It's a whole RAID system. You have to be very knowledgeable about what's there. These are going to be RAID in a corporate environment.
Of course.
You have to know all the pieces and how they.
All the information we have to know.
Yeah.
We have to know. And
what you were just describing is more recovery than actual.
This is recovery, yes. Anything else?
So if you've got nefarious plans, put it on the cloud. Then you can delete it. Nobody can recover.
The government can.
I think there are copies of everything. Anything you text gets copies. That's my experience.
Here's a sort of tongue-in-cheek, wise-ass kind of question. Is anybody with probably proper authority to do this, which might let you at least feel safe to talk a little bit, asked you to add things in the tails of files and things or put on the disk things in a way where it'd be hard to do computer user, but to leave
you're
everything
basically
on the disk intact, and you can fake their delta.
See if I understand it correctly. You're asking us, can we fake evidence so that forensic engineers cannot find?
And it will look, forensic
engineers
can find it, but it will look as though it really got there because the guy did it when he did it.
It's called working for the NSA.
Yes. The answer is yes. Gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, just
want to
thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having us.
If you want to call me, please remind me of this meeting. My direct cell phone is on the card. Any technical questions you have, no problem. Can we go?